I will give you a lecture this afternoon, not a sermon.
Ovo danas popodne će biti predavanje, a ne propovjed.
And if you like history and a little theology, you will enjoy it.
Ako volite istoriju i malo i teologije, onda ćete uživati u tome.
If not, you will enjoy it. Or...
You the what?
If you don't, you will enjoy it anyway.
Ako ne volite, ipak ćete uživati.
We're going to talk about the theology of the last generation.
Govorit ćemo o teologiji posljednje generacije.
And I suppose that many of you, if not all of you, know about this theology.
I ja vjerujem da mnogi od vas, ako ne možda i svi, znate o ovoj teologiji.
According to this theology,
prema ovoj teologiji,
the last generation will have to reach a level of perfection.
Posljednja generacija će morati da dosegne nivo savršenstva
that will make it possible to vindicate the character of God before the universe.
Posljednja generacija će morati da dosegne takav nivo savršenstva da odbrani Boži karakter pred svemirom.
This theology was developed particularly to explain the delay of the second coming.
Ova teologija se posebno razvila da bi se objasnilo odlaganje ili kašnjenje drugog dolaska.
This is a question that Adventists do need to address. The question of why hasn't Christ come back?
To je znači odgovor na pitanje zašto se Hristos još nije vratio.
And some Adventists have tried to address the theological issue.
I neki Adventisti su pokušali da se pozabave sa ovim teološkim pitanjem.
And I think I have, I hope you have, I have your name right, Laszlo.
Ja mislim da Laszlo.
One of your theologians, I don't know where he is.
Jedan od vaših teologa.
Oh, he's right here.
Evo ga tu.
I was talking to him and he told me I'm really immersed in research to address this topic.
I on mi je rekao, ja sam zaista se duboko pozabavio sa ovim pitanjem.
Because some Adventists feel that Christ should have already come.
I neki Adventisti smatruju da je Hristos već trebalo da dođe.
And they try to explain why he hasn't come.
I pokušavaju da objasne zašto nije došao.
And this theology that I'm going to talk to you, they answer the question saying,
i to je ova teologija koja odgovara na to pitanje i oni kažu,
Christ has not come because we have not reached the level of perfection that Christ that God expects from us.
I onda kažu, Hristos još nije došao jer mi nismo dosegli nivo savršenstva koji Hristos očekuje od nas.
Others are saying Christ has not come because we have not understood righteousness by faith.
Ili drugi će reći, Hristos nije došao zato što nismo razumjeli pitanje opravdanja vjerom.
Now this specific topic, the last generation.
Ova specifična tema posljednja generacija.
This has become an issue again in the church.
To je ponovo postalo aktuelno pitanje u crkvi.
In the 60s and 70s this was a big issue in America.
60-ih i 70-ih godina to je bilo jedno krupno pitanje u Americi.
It did not totally disappear, but almost disappeared.
A onda nije baš potpuno nestalo, ali skoro da je nestalo.
Now it's back to life.
A sada je opet oživjelo.
And we're finding it in different places in the world.
I pronalazimo to pitanje u različitim dijelima svijeta.
You may not have it here, but it's on his way.
Možda ga još nemate ovdje, ali na putu je.
History, a little history.
Malo historije.
Who introduced this idea into Adventist theology?
Ko je prvi unio ovo u adventističku teologiju?
A man called M.L. Andreessen.
Čovjek po imenu M.L. Andreessen.
20th century, second half of the century.
Druga polovina 20. vijeka.
He was trying to understand how Adventist soteriology, eschatology could be integrated with the doctrine of the sanctuary and the second coming of Christ.
On je pokušao da objasni kako adventistička soteriologija ili nauka o spasenju i eshatologija, nauka u posljednjem vremenu, mogu da se uklope u pitanje svetinje.
And he came up with the last generation.
I onda je on rekao, to je ta posljednja generacija.
And I'm going to give you several points that he used.
I daću vam neke osnovne tačke kojih se on držao.
He began, number one, with the origin of sin.
On je počeo prvo sa porijeklom grijeha.
He argued
njegov argument
Lucifer,
je bio da je
Lucifer looked at God,
posmatrao Boga
and challenged his authority,
izazvao je njegov autoritet,
his government, his
njegovu
law,
vladu, njegov zakon.
And he told God, you have this law that nobody can observe.
I rekao je Bogu, ti imaš ovaj zakon koji niko ne može da drži.
You are an unjust God.
Ti si nepravedan Bog.
And if you believe something else, God, you have to show us.
I ako ti, Bože, drugačije smatraš, trebaš to da nam dokažeš.
The system of government that you have is not just, is not right.
Sistem tvoje vladavine Bože nije pravedan, nije ispravan.
So he took God to court.
I on je praktično Boga odveo na sud.
And God, according to Andreessen,
i Bog prema Andreasenu,
concluded that he was responsible to submit evidence to the universe that will demonstrate that he was a loving and righteous God.
On je morao da dokaze cijelom univerzumu i da demonstrira da on jeste Bog ljubavi i da je pravedan.
So how was he going to do that? How?
Kako on to sad može da uradi?
Second point.
Druga tačka.
Human beings fell into sin.
Ljudska bića su pala u grijeh.
And now God saw this as his opportunity.
I sada Bog vidi to kao njegovu priliku.
To use humans in order to demonstrate that he was a loving and righteous God.
Da koristi ljudska bića da demonstrira da on jeste Bog ljubavi i da je pravedan.
He gives the impression that the human fall into sin was a good thing for God.
To nam daje utisak da taj pad čovjeka u grijeh je bila dobra stvar za Boga.
Number three.
Broj tri.
Christ and the vindication of God.
Hristos i odbrana Boga.
According to Andreessen, the only thing God had to produce.
Prema Andreessenu, jedina stvar koju je Bog trebao da stvori.
In order to demonstrate that he was a righteous God and a loving God.
Da bi pokazao da on jeste pravedan i Bog ljubavi.
All he had to produce was one single human being who was able to obey his law.
Bilo bi dovoljno da ima jednog čovjeka koji bi bio u stanju da drži njegov zakon.
Just one.
Samo jednoga.
So you would expect him to say this one was Jesus.
Očekivali bi se da kaže pa taj jedan je bio Isus.
No, he doesn't say that.
Ali ne kaže on to.
Jesus did not vindicate God.
Isus nije odbranio Boga.
Jesus came to be a model for us.
Isus je došao kao primjer za nas.
The ones who have to vindicate God are we, human beings.
Oni koji treba da odbrane Boga smo mi kao ljudska bića.
Where did he get that from?
A odakle je to dobio?
Day of Atonement.
Dan očišćenja.
The doctrine of the sanctuary.
Doktrina svetinje.
Two services, daily annual.
Dvije službe, dnevna i godišnja.
The daily service was represented the forgiveness of sins.
Dnevna služba je predstavljala oproštenje grijeha.
But the Day of Atonement.
Ali dan očišćenja.
Was about cleansing.
Tu je trebalo da se desi čišćenje.
Transforming sinners.
Transformisanje grešnika.
Making them perfect.
I da se postigne da oni budu savršeni.
And of course, typologically, the Day of Atonement is after 1844.
A naravno tipološki dan očišćenja je nakon 1844. godine.
This last generation living during the Day of Atonement.
Tako ta posljednja generacija koja živi u danu očišćenja ili pomirenja,
they have to develop this perfect character through which God will be vindicated before the cosmos.
Ta generacija treba da razvije taj savršeni karakter kroz koji će Bog biti odbranjen pred cijelim svemirom, kosmosom.
Christ will come.
I onda će Hristos doći.
You see?
Are you
following me?
Jel me pratite?
I'm assuming you are.
Pretpostavljam da me pratite.
Total victory over sin.
Potpuna pobjeda nad grehom.
The last generation,
posljednja generacija,
will live on this earth without sin.
Će na ovoj zemlji živjeti bez grijeha.
This theology had a tremendous influence during the 60s, 70s, and even today.
Ova teologija imala ogroman utjecaj u vrijeme 60-ih, 70-ih, pa čak i danas.
I don't have time to go into details, so let me tell you a few things.
Nemam vremena da idem u detalje, pa evo da vam kažem nekoliko stvari.
We have in the church different theological tendencies.
Mi u crkvi imamo različite teološke tendencije.
We have what we call the people in the extreme right.
Imamo ljude koje zovemo ekstremna desnica.
These are the people who says, you know, the church is bad, the church is in apostasy.
Ljudi koji kažu crkva je loša, ona je u otpadu.
These individuals in the 60s embraced this theology.
I te osobe u 60-im godinama su prihvatile ovu teologiju.
And they introduced into the Adventist church a heavy emphasis on legalism.
I oni su unijeli u adventističku crkvu teški naglasak na legalizmu.
By the late 60s, apparently this tendency was quieted down.
I onda je izgledalo da krajem 60-ih ta tendencija se dosta povukla.
But then in the 70s, the unexpected happened.
Ali onda 70-ih godina neočekivano se desilo.
Two wonderful Adventist theologians.
Dva divna adventistička teologa.
Embraced it.
Su prihvatila to.
Herbert Douglas. It's a wonderful man. He died recently.
To je divan čovjek koji je nedavno umro.
Anybody who met this man was impressed.
And kogod da je upoznao tog čovjeka, bio je impresioniran njim.
Positively.
U pozitivnom smislu.
I one of those.
I ja sam jedan od njih.
In fact, his theology was very good in most ways.
U stvari, njegova teologija je bila vrlo dobra po mnogim pitanjima.
But he had a concern about the delay of the coming of the Lord.
Ali on je bio zabrinut zbog tog odlaganja Hristovog dolaska.
So he developed the idea of the theology of the harvest.
I onda je on razvio tu teologiju žetve.
The Spirit came and Pentecost and the harvest began to mature.
Sveti Duh je došao za vrijeme 50-nice i žetva je počela da raste.
And at the end the Spirit will come and mature the harvest.
A na kraju će doći Sveti Duh i učinit će da sazri ta žetva.
And this harvest by this is talking about character development.
A kad govorimo o toj žetvi, govorimo o razvoju karaktera.
Living a life free from sin.
I da živimo život slobodan od grijeha.
He believed, this is important, that Jesus vindicated the Father.
On je vjerovao, ovo je važno, da Isus jeste odbranio Oca.
So he disagreed with Andreasen.
Tako da je u tome se razlikovao, nije se slagao sa Andreasenom.
But then he added.
Ali onda je dodao.
This vindication that Christ achieved will be completed through the last generation. Did you get that? I'm sorry.
Tako da ova odbrana koju je Hristos uradio će biti upotpunjena kroz ono što će uraditi posljednja generacija.
Did you hear what he said?
Jeste čuli šta je rekao?
What Jesus did was not enough.
Ono što je Isus učinio nije bilo dovoljno.
It is a serious statement.
Što je ozbiljna izjava, vrlo ozbiljna.
Was incomplete and now we have to complete it through a last generation that lives on earth free from sin.
Tako da sada mi treba da to upotpunimo kroz poslovnu generaciju koja će živjeti bez greha na ovoj zemlji.
The second theologian that embraced these ideas was Mervyn Maxwell.
Drugi teolog koji je prihvatio ovu ideju, ovaj koncept je bio Mervyn Maxwell.
He was a teacher at the seminary for many years.
On je bio profesor na našem fakultetu dugo godina.
Another wonderful person.
Još jedna divna osoba.
But in this area he drifted toward the extreme.
He did what?
Drifted toward the extreme.
Ali na ovom području on je otišao malo u ekstrem.
And he believed that the last generation will develop a perfect character.
I on je također vjerovao da će posljednja generacija razviti savršen karakter.
The result of this was strong legalism during those decades.
I rezultat ovoga je bio teški legalizam za vrijeme tih decenija.
Two theologians faced this challenge.
Posle su dva teologa koja su se suočila s ovim problemom.
The first one was Edward Heppenstall.
Prvi je bio Edward Heppenstall.
And the second one was Hans Kanz Larondel.
A drugi je bio Hans Larondel.
And I tell you, their writings were a blessing for the church at the time when they wrote.
Ja vam mogu reći da su njihovi spisi bili blagoslov za crkvu u ono vrijeme kada su pisali.
They helped a lot to change the trends.
Oni su puno pomogli da se promijeni pravac.
And I don't have time to get into the details on how they achieved it, but it was clear for them that sin was not simply actions.
Nemam vremena da idem u detalje kako su oni to postigli, uglavnom oni su pokazali da grijeh nisu samo djela.
Those on the side of perfectionism define sin as disobeying the law.
Oni na strani perfekcionizma opisuju grijeh kao neposlušnost zakonu.
This theologian said sin is a deeper issue, a deeper matter.
A ovi teolozi su rekli, grijeh je nešto dublje pitanje.
Sin is not simply doing, but being.
Grijeh nije samo ono što činimo, nego ono što mi jesmo.
Sin is our condition.
Grijeh je stanje u kojem se nalazimo.
Separation from God.
Odvojenost od Boga.
Everything we do, even the good things we do, are tainted by sin.
Sve što činimo, čak i dobre stvari koje činimo, su uprljane grijehom.
Everything.
Sve.
So they said, perfection is growing in Christ.
Tako da su oni rekli, savršenstvo je u stvari rast u Hristu.
Perfection is a total commitment to Christ.
Savršenstvo je u stvari potpuno predanje Hristu.
And total reliance on his forgiving grace.
I potpuno oslanjanje na njegovu praštajuću blagodat.
And I will argue in a few moments that they were fundamentally right.
I ja ću uskoro da ustvrdim da su oni bili zaista u pravu.
So let me say something about evaluation. Let's try to evaluate these views.
Hajde da sada malo ocijenimo ove poglede.
Number one.
Broj jedan.
This teaching is not found in the writings of Ellen G. White.
Ovo učenje se ne nalazi u spisima Ellen White.
That is to say, the idea that the last generation has to develop a perfect character in order to vindicate God before the cosmos is not in Ellen White.
To znači da ideja da poslednja generacija treba da razvije savršen karakter da bi Boga odbranila se ne nalazi u spisima Ellen White.
For Ellen White, the one who vindicated the character of God, the law of God, the love of God, the honor of God was Christ.
Za Ellen White, onaj koji je odbranio Božju čast, Božju pravednost, Božji karakter je bio Hristos.
His life, his ministry,
njegov
the
život,
cross,
njegova služba i krst,
and particularly the cross.
A posebno krst.
We heard about the cross this morning.
Mi smo govorili o krstu jutros.
This is the place where God was vindicated.
Na tom mjestu je Bog bio odbranjen.
You don't need anything else.
Nije vam potrebno ništa više.
If that is not enough, it's not enough.
Ako to nije dovoljno, onda
it's useless.
Nije dovoljno, onda je bez svrhe.
So I can multiply statements from Ellen G. White where she again and again goes back to Jesus as the one through whom God vindicated himself.
Tako da bih ja sada mogao iznijeti mnogobrojne citate Ellen White gdje ona govori o Isusu kako je on odbranio Božji karakter.
Number two,
broj dva,
is based, this idea is based on a misunderstanding of Christian perfection.
Ova ideja je zasnovana na pogrešnom razumijevanju hrišćanskog savršenstva.
Now the issue is difficult. Okay, Christian perfection is difficult. Ellen G. White has a lot to say about this, but it has to be read in its proper context.
Ovo je jedno teško pitanje i Ellen White puno ima o tome da kaže, ali se mora čitati u svom pravom kontekstu.
There is no question that through Christ we can overcome sin.
Nema pitanja, mi sigurno možemo kroz Hrista pobijediti grijeh.
This is what the Christian life is, overcoming sin in our lives.
To jeste hrišćanski život, pobjeđivanje grijeha u našim životima.
This is a quote that they used from Ellen G. White.
Ovo je citat koji oni koriste od Ellen White.
When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people.
Kada se Hristov karakter bude savršeno reprodukovao ili ponovio u njegovom narodu,
then he will come to claim them as his own.
Onda će on doći da ih uzme kao svoje.
And the question is how would this happen? How?
I pitanje je kako će sad to da se desi?
Does it mean that we're going to reach a condition where we're finally free from sin?
Da li to znači da ćemo mi dosegnuti stanje u kojem smo slobodni potpuno od greha?
What kind of perfection is she talking about?
O kakvom savršenstvu ona tu stvari govori?
I'm going to suggest to you based on the Bible and Ellen G. White.
Ja bih vam predložio na osnovu onog što piše u Bibliji u duhu proroštva
that the perfect reproduction of the character of Christ in our lives.
Da savršena reprodukcija ili ponavljanje Hristovog karaktera u našem životu
is only possible.
Je moguće samo
if two elements are present in our Christian experience.
Ako su dva elementa prisutna u našem hrišćanskom iskustvu.
Now listen, don't go to sleep.
Nemojte sada zaspite, nego slušajte.
This is important and it's going to show up in a quiz that you will take on Tuesday.
I ovo je jako važno i ovo ćete morati da odgovorite na kvizu, odnosno, znači, utorak će biti test mali.
Number one.
Broj jedan.
Growing in grace.
Rasti u blagodati.
A true Christian is one who is constantly growing in grace.
Istinski hrišćanin je onaj koji stalno raste u blagodati.
And number two,
i broj dva,
this person is always in a constant spirit of contrition and repentance.
Ova osoba je u konstantnom, stalnom duhu pokajanja i skrušenosti.
Došto?
Te dve stvari.
You grow.
Vi rastete.
You grow.
I rastete.
But since you are aware that sin is more than actions.
Ali pošto ste svjesni da grijeh je nešto više od naših djela,
that the best sermon you can preach is tainted by sin.
Da najbolja propovjed koju možete ispropovijedati je na neki način umrljana grijehom.
You exist, you live in a state of constant repentance.
Vi postojite, živite u duhu stalnog pokajanja.
This is important because the first one,
ovo je važno jer ova prva stvar,
growing in Christ,
rasti u Hristu,
protect you
štiti
from
vas
a formal religion.
Od jedne formalne religije.
I go to church, Sabbath,
idem subotom u crkvu,
go home and I don't care.
Dam desetak i onda odem kući i nije mi više briga.
The lordship of Christ over us requires that we are constantly growing in Christ.
To što je Isus naš Gospod zahtijeva da mi stalno rastemo u Hristu.
The second one.
Drugo.
Living in a state of constant repentance at the end of the day.
Živiti u duhu stalnog pokajanja na kraju svih krajeva.
Before I go to sleep.
Prije što odem na spavanje.
After giving several seminars here.
Nakon što održim nekoliko ovdje predavanja.
And praying and singing with you.
I molim se i pjevam sa vama.
I go on my knees before I go to sleep.
Otići ću na svoja koljena prije što odem na spavanje.
And I say to the Lord,
i reći ću Gospodu,
Lord, have mercy on me.
Gospode, budi milosti meni.
If I did something wrong today, please forgive me.
Ako sam nešto pogrešno učinio danas, molim te oprosti
constant
mi.
Constant state of repentance.
Stalno stanje pokajanja.
No legalism.
Ne legalizam.
Humble.
Poniznost.
Yourself before the Lord.
Ponizite sebe pred Gospodom.
Now my time is running out. Let me read a statement from Ellen G. White.
Vrijeme mi bježi, da vam pročitam nešto od Ellen White.
Because this is what I told you is from Ellen G. White. I have every biblical evidence, but the way I'm putting it together is from Ellen G. White.
Ovo je sve od Ellen White, imamo i biblijske dokaze, evo sada sam ovo uzeo.
When you do listen carefully to this statement.
Slušajte pažljivo ovu izjavu.
Because it's one of the few statements in which Ellen G. White explains to us the process of salvation.
Jer to je jedna od onih izjava u kojima nam Ellen White objašnjava proces spasenja.
What some theologians call the order of salvation, the things that happen in order to be saved.
To neki teolozi zovu poredak spasenja, red spasenja.
As the penitent sinner,
dok pokajnički grešnik,
contrite before God,
skrušen pred Bogom,
discerns Christ's atonement in his behalf,
Svata Hristovu pomirničku žrtvu u njegovu korist,
and accepts this atonement as his only hope in this life and in the future life,
i prihvata to pomirenje kao njegovu jedinu nadu u ovom životu i u njegovom budućem životu,
his sins are pardoned.
Njegovi grijesi su oprošteni.
This is justification by faith. You got it?
To je opravdanje vjerom. Jeste razumjeli?
So the penitent sinner sees Christ.
Pokajnički grešnik vidi Hrista.
And see the atonement.
I vidi to pomirenje.
And he realizes that he did it for me.
I kaže, pa on je to učinio za
and
mene.
There is repentance inside the heart.
I u njegovom srcu je pokajanje.
And he is forgiven.
I njemu je oprošteno.
Then she goes on.
I onda ona nastavlja.
Every believing soul is to conform his will entirely to God's will.
Svaka duša koja vjeruje treba da uskladi svoju volju u potpunosti sa Božjom voljom.
So you were justified by faith?
Dakle, upravo ste opravdani vjerom.
What follows?
Ono što slijedi,
you begin to grow in grace.
Vi počinjete da rastete u blagodati.
You begin to conform your life to the will of the Father.
Vi usklađujete svoj život sa voljom Očevom.
That's the first thing that happens.
To je prva stvar koja se dešava.
And what is the second thing?
A šta je druga stvar?
She says,
ona kaže,
and keep in a state of repentance and contrition.
I držati u stanju pokajanja i skrušenosti.
Exercising faith in the atoning merits of the Redeemer.
Stavljajući svoju vjeru na pomirujuće zasluge našeg otkupitelja.
And advancing from strength to strength, from glory to glory.
I napredujući iz snage u snagu i slave u slavu.
There you have it.
Evo ga tu.
You see, Christ, the Spirit draws you to Him. You accept Him as a Savior.
Vi vidite Hrista, Sveti Duh vas privlači ka njemu, vi ga prihvatate i Otac vas zagrli,
accepts you,
prihvati vas.
And the life, the Christian life begin. You begin to grow.
I onda počinje hrišćanski život, vi počinjete da rastete.
But she says, you also keep yourself in a state of repentance and contrition.
Ali ona isto tako kaže, vi sebe držite u stanju pokajanja i skrušenosti.
So you begin with contrition and repentance.
Vi počinjete sa skrušenošću i pokajanjem.
Then you go growing in Christ.
I onda idete rastući u Hristu.
But you do that without leaving this condition.
Ali vi to činite bez da napustite to stanje.
Understand me?
Da li me razumijete?
The contrition and repentance that you begin with.
To pokajanje i ta skrušenost s kojim ste počeli.
You never leave it behind you.
To nikada ne napuštate, ne ostavljate iza sebe.
No, you begin the Christian life accompanied by this condition.
Nego nastavljate vaš hrišćanski život, ali njega prati ovo stanje.
And as long as we have these two together, we are perfect in Christ.
I dok imamo ove dve stvari zajedno, mi smo savršeni u Hristu.
That's what she means.
To je ono što ona misli.
I think this is what you find in the Old Testament sacrificial system and what you find in the New Testament.
To je ono što ja smatram da pronalazimo u žrtvenom sistemu Starog Zaveta i ono što pronalazimo u Novom Zavetu.
I want to come back to the vindication of God.
Želim da se vratim na onu odbranu Boga.
I told you that the sacrifice of Christ vindicated God.
Rekao sam vam da je Hristova žrtva odbranila Boga.
But I want also to tell you.
Ali vam također želim reći.
That the sacrifice of Christ was made to save the cosmos.
Žrtva Hristova je bila učinjena da bi spasila cijeli kosmos.
That is to say, it had a soteriological function.
Što znači da je imala soteriološku spasilačku funkciju.
If the sacrifice of Christ was intended primarily to vindicate God, we face a serious theological problem.
Ali kada kažemo da je Hristova žrtva bila tu učinjena prvenstveno da bi odbranila Boga, onda imamo jedan teološki problem.
God has become his own object of love.
Bog tu bi onda postao svoj sopstveni predmet ljubavi.
God has become selfishness.
Onda bi Bog postao sebičnost.
His concern about his own image.
Njega brine slika koju neko ima o njemu.
And what he did in Christ was primarily to clean himself up.
I ono što je učinio kroz Hrista jeste prvenstveno tu da bi on sebe očistio.
And then by accident he saved us.
A onda eto tako nekako usput nas i spasio.
See, this is what I don't think they have seen. They have seen, they have not seen this.
To je ono kada imate grijeh.
They have destroyed the character of God.
Oni su razorili karakter Boži.
But in Ellen G. White, in the scripture, how does God vindicate himself?
Ali u pismu i kod Ellen White, kako Bog sebe brani?
He vindicated himself by forgetting about himself.
On je sebe odbranio time što je zaboravio na sebe.
By doing everything he did for the benefit of his creation.
Time što je učinio sve što je učinio za u korist onih koje je stvorio.
What he did was not for his own benefit.
Ono što je učinio nije bilo njemu u korist.
He has no need supply.
On nema takvu potrebu.
He did it for the benefit of the creation.
On je to učinio u korist onog što je stvorio.
He, write this down, he vindicated himself by being himself.
Zapišite ovo, on je sebe odbranio time što je bio on.
He is a God of love.
On je Bog ljubavi.
And he was himself.
I jednostavno je bio to što jeste.
He saved the cosmos, not only this planet. This planet is a little thing.
On je spasio cijeli kosmos, ne samo ovu malu planetu.
The whole cosmos.
Cijeli kosmos je spasio.
He did it to save the cosmos, not himself. He didn't have any problem.
On je to učinio da bi spasio kosmos, ne sebe. On nije imao nikakvih problema.
So I have to stop. I have 4 seconds.
Za 4 sekunde treba da završim.
And I conclude telling you this.
I zaključit ću govoreći vam ovo.
The sacrifice of Christ.
Žrtva Hristova
is the only thing
je jedina stvar
that will protect the cosmos from another insurrection of sin. Is that good English?
Žrtva Hristova je jedina stvar koja će spriječiti da se greh ponovo pojavi u svemiru.
It's not that we're going to be so perfect.
To nije da ćemo mi postati tako savršeni.
Because we're so perfect in heaven, sin will not rise again.
I onda pošto mi tako savršeni, greh se na nebu neće ponovo pojaviti.
That's not the case.
Nije to slučaj.
The efficacy of the sacrifice of Christ is eternal.
Učinkovitost Hristove žrtve je vječna.
Listen to Ellen G. White.
Čujte što Ellen White kaže.
It is through the efficacy of the cross.
Kroz učinkovitost krsta
that the angels in of heaven are guarded from apostasy.
Anđeli nebeski su sačuvani od otpada.
Without the cross they would not be more secure against evil.
Bez krsta oni ne bi bili bezbjedniji od zla
that were the angels before the fall.
Nego što su bili anđeli prije pada.
Eternal efficacy.
Vječna učinkovitost.
There is no going to be a time throughout eternity.
Neće postojati neko vrijeme ikada u vječnost.
When the sacrifice of Christ.
Kada žrtva Hristova
would be put in the files in heaven.
To be put in what?
In the files, in the archives.
Aha. Kada će žrtva Hristova biti stavljena u neku arhivu nebesku?
It will remain alive forever.
Ostaće živa za uvijek.
And God is going to make sure that that happens.
A Bog će se pobrinuti da se to zaista tako i desi.
Because we will spend eternity.
Jer ćemo provesti vječnost.
Studying the sacrifice of Christ.
Proučavajući žrtvu Hristovu.
It is by the grace of God that we will get there. No, not through efforts that will develop a perfect sinless human being.
Kroz žrtvu Hristovu i blagodat njegovu mi ćemo doći na nebo, ne kroz naše napore da postanemo savršeni.
So I tell you.
Tako želim da vam kažem.
Go and sin no more.
Idite i ne grešite više.
And then kneel down.
A onda se pomolite.
And ask the Lord to forgive you.
I tražite Gospodu da vam oprosti.